Hello and welcome to the Addiction Recovery Revolution. I'm your host, Debbie Nelson, and I'm happy to welcome Leonard Bushell from Real Recovery. Welcome, Leonard.
Good morning, good day, good evening.
I really am excited to kind of share because you do so much work within, you kind of combine two passions of yours and made it into this wonderful thing called Real Recovery.
Yes, Real Recovery Film Festival and Symposium, combining my passions for recovery and the arts and film. I've also added my fascination with having been a news junkie for many years, focusing on all the interesting, appropriate, newest, most relevant news in the treatment and addiction world. With the weekly Addiction Recovery e-bulletin that goes to 24,000 people every week. So I've been able to not just incorporate my love of the arts and film, but also news and information. I think education and information is incredibly important to people in or out of recovery. And of course, it's very important now to the country in general to get real news about real issues and real breakthroughs in science and medicine and spirituality.
I think that's what's exciting is that there are people that are trying to break through this epidemic. You know, there's more and more people doing it, but they're doing it in, that's what the internet is opening up, a whole new avenue to help people get the information that they want.
I thought the internet was opening up a whole new avenue to pornography addiction.
That it does too.
Especially for young people, which is tragic. Right.
Yeah, it was interesting. I've had several different people that have all their different takes on kind of the sensory overloads that are happening with the internet and how we're all trying to basically kind of soothe that overstimulation that we're getting.
You know, I was with a friend last night who told me that 5 days ago, a friend of his called and told him that his father had died. And my friend forgot that he had been told that, because he's constantly getting news alerts and emails and texts. And when you have 100 bits of information coming at you in a relatively short amount of time, the really important ones don't always stand out because you don't give them the time to sit with it or contemplate it because, oh, my friend's father died, and then there's another message and you don't even process it. So I think the overstimulation, which has been going on for years, but never at the rate it is now. I'm guilty of extreme distractions through media sources.
And it's interesting because looking behind you, you have all these books. And nowadays, you know, you wonder how many people are actually ever crack a book and smell a book.
Some people are. Some people still do.
Right.
Getting harder. I went into my local Jamaican restaurant the other day for lunch, and there were two guys at one table and two individuals at another table, and they all had their phones, all looking at the phone. Or it's not a phone, it's a computer. You're looking at the rest of the world. You're looking at your friends. Right. You're looking at incredibly important, interesting information, or maybe even TV shows. But 10 years ago, one of them would have had a book. One of the guys sitting alone would have had a book or even a newspaper.
Right.
And now they don't. I feel so bad for book publishers. They must be fighting this Sisyphus type of battle to try and get people still to pick up a hardback or a paperback and read it. You know, so
I think the information, I mean, with Real Recovery, what you're trying to accomplish, you're bringing forth a lot of documentaries and things that the world is.
Great documentaries. We bring great features.
Right.
I'm currently working at a addiction conference, and on our table we have a big monitor where we're showing the movie Shame over and over, the great movie with Michael Fassbender, made by the Oscar-winning director whose name I just spazzed out on. It's a New York story about a gentleman who possibly has sex addiction. And until I saw this movie, I thought sex addiction was maybe something that was, people used it as an excuse. Ozzy Osbourne in this week's Addiction Recovery E-Bulletin, Ozzy Osbourne in this, to not being a sex addict like he claimed 2 years ago when he got caught with all these improprieties. He just said it because then, oh, it's a diagnosis. Oh, it's an illness. I don't have to take responsibility for my actions because I have a disease, the sex addiction disease. But he just came out and said, I had no sex addiction. I'm a rock star and blah, blah, blah. I think the same thing was true for Tiger Woods. I think he just went into treatment for sex addiction to not lose his contracts from Nike, which hopefully he still did. He was just, you know, a rich, famous guy who liked blondes. Nothing wrong with that. So the point is that we're showing this movie Shame because it convinced me that sex addiction does exist, which is the value of some of our films that we show. And we show films like Leaving Las Vegas. There is no more accurate depiction of a hope to die alcoholic in the film Leaving Las Vegas, which is a true story. So I really love it when therapists come to our films, because even though they might treat addicts and alcoholics, they really don't get to see exactly how they live other than when they're in the office. So they get a very accurate depiction of what these people's lifestyles are about. And they're not all tragic, because we know, you know, addiction, if it's a disease, or alcoholism is a disease, it's the only disease that people love having until they don't. You know, there's gloriousness. There is a search for meaning and God in addiction until it becomes deadly and an incredible tragedy for the individual, but more than the family, because the individual is seeking release. You know, he wants to, I shall be released. It's the family left behind that suffers the tragedy, because everyone's on their way to wherever, maybe at 30, maybe at 50, maybe at 90. The destination is very similar for everyone. It's just a matter of timing.
Well, that's what I always say. I wish I knew, like I could never pinpoint, some people can. For myself, I don't know when I crossed that line in the sand. I don't know. I all of a sudden realized, woke up one day and said, geez, I can't stop. And then it's wonderful because then you go down that next path where you say, well, yeah, but my life is really, tomorrow's going to be different. Tomorrow's different. Uh-huh. And then tomorrow hits, and then about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, you say, you know, today was an extremely stressful day. I deserve to unwind, like the whole rest of the world unwinds.
Yeah. Well, you know, I did cocaine for 13 years, but I was only a coke addict for 1 year, luckily. And that was the 13th year, because for 12 years, every time I did a line or a spoon, I wanted to. That was my goal. That was my purpose. That was my way of life. It was in the 13th year that I would say, I'm not going to do a line before lunch. And I would do it anyway. Or I would say, I'm not going to do more than 4 lines tonight. But then I would do 6. And to me, that's the definition of addiction. When you don't want to do something and you do it anyway. While you're still enjoying it and wanting to do it, it's a lifestyle. It's only when you realize you can't stop. I remember once driving over the Golden Gate Bridge with my sunroof open, and I had a vial of Coke, and I was going into San Francisco, and I thought, I'm going to throw this out the sunroof into the San Francisco Bay. And I had it in my hand, and I didn't throw it out because I thought if I threw it out, it would mean I had a problem. And so I didn't throw it out. And it was only really when I got to the Betty Ford Center and did my first step that I realized how insane my life had been. Even though I'd really almost died once in the hospital, 3 days unconscious, a number of other mishaps, it wasn't until I did the first step that I could see, that I could look back and see, wow, I'm insane. And I don't want to be insane. I didn't mind being an addict, but I don't want to be insane. And that started my journey to recovery by just saying, wow, I'm still alive and I could have been dead so many times. This is a chance for me to change direction and see what this life of abstinence or the Lord's Prayer or the St. Francis Prayer or the Serenity Prayer, how that might replace my desire to be high all the time. As my son said something very good after I got out of rehab. He said, Dad, Timothy Leary said, the goal is not to get high. The goal is to be high. And I tell people now when I go to rehab this week, I said, the only problem with drugs is that you come down. You come down.
Right.
So here, there's no way to come down. It's very trippy. It's very trippy with no substances to buffer your perception of reality or people. It's wild. It's wild.
That's a great, I love that. That's wonderful. And then you kind of crossed over and you actually did counseling.
I did. I worked at a rehab for a number of years, sort of as penance for my behavior for the previous 26 years.
You didn't help all the rest of the people. You kind of went back and said, I'm going to.
Somehow God was, let me change that. I got really lucky and never went to jail. And every day, if nothing else, I know that if a car pulls up and screeches to a halt outside my house, they're not coming for me. And for years, I thought they were. So now I know they're not. So it's a great, I mean, talk about grateful. I mean, to still be alive, if you value life. And I understand a lot of young people now are missing certain aspects to their actual brain function where they might not appreciate that life is special, that life is miraculous, that life is a once in a lifetime deal, maybe, I don't know, and that they don't care if they die. They just assume.
Many times that people get to the point in their use, I know with myself, even though I guess logically speaking, I knew that I had a lot to live for and wanted to live. The other part of me, you get to a point where you don't care. I didn't care.
Right. Well, I always.
Everyone gets to that. But I mean, for myself, and like you said, I'm incredibly blessed. You get to the other side of things and you can start looking at people and you cease to be judgmental in the sense, like you said, you're incredibly grateful that it wasn't you. I'm incredibly grateful I didn't have a DUI.
Right.
Many, many times I drank totally wasted. So you tend not to, you look at someone and realize, oh, they got caught. It caught up with them.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't. I was very lucky, I say many, many times, and blessed that that didn't happen to me. But that for the people that it does happen to, you know, their journey back, oftentimes, sometimes that's the low that they needed to make it back.
Mm-hmm.
So there's so many things that are happening within the recovery world. You know, you tapped on several different things. There's all different people that are kind of changing what addiction recovery looks like nowadays, and we're incorporating science like they never have before, you know.
Yes, they are incorporating science. I don't know which science that is.
Well, I mean, I have all different people that are anything from, we have, you know, heart math that we've done interviews with.
Right. So sort of like the technologies around some like human potential growth methods.
Right. No, I mean,
people think of science as medication.
Medically assisted treatment
is where it's at.
I agree. I think that the science also is just catching up to recognizing some of the things of conscious awareness and how to do that and how to achieve it.
I agree.
You have to watch some of my...
It's amazing that they don't teach poetry in rehabs. Really.
Pardon me?
It's amazing they don't have poetry classes in most rehabs.
Well, I think they also, they're starting to integrate recognizing how the arts are incredibly healing.
Yes.
How music is incredibly healing. How artistic things are incredibly healing. And that's what that's my whole method in what I'm doing is saying whatever path gives people added benefit for healing, continue to go down those paths. Because to continue to fortify recovery is essential.
Yes, it is.
And whatever method continues to give you the
help of others, and yet it's an inside job. No one can sit in that chair for you.
Right.
No one can sit on that meditation pad mat for you. No one can do your yoga for you.
Right.
People can help get you there, but you have to do the work yourself. And it's not easy, and it's very uncomfortable, and a lot of people... I was asked the other day about how do you handle boredom when you get sober? And I said, I used to do a group on, you have to find your inner nerd to stay sober. Because there are times when just nerdiness hits you and you have to be able to take a walk or read a book. Personally, films are my drug of choice. I just saw a film the other day, it was 2 hours and 45 minutes. And for 2 hours and 45 minutes, I didn't think about my problems. I didn't think about death. I didn't think about anything that was going on with me. I was totally focused on this story, which I find is like a break, the way drugs used to take me out of my problems. A film can do it too. You know, a good film, not a bad film, a bad film. Just leave, after you get sick on the Raisinets.
Milk duds.
Just raisins, they're natural.
I think you're right. I think it's dead on. Finding your passion and whatever your passion happens to be. Now, what you did, which was, you, like I said, you obviously have more than one passion, but you took something and it was an inspiration to you that you said, I want to kind of marry two of these worlds, which is unusual. I don't think the world as a whole, we're finally getting a society that is dropping the stigmatism, and we're starting to, more and more people are coming out and saying, hey, I'm in recovery. When you're comfortable and you're able to do that, I think it's highly beneficial because it brings it to light and puts a face on something that once, I lived in the suburbs.
Sorry to hear that.
I was a suburb mom that drove my children to dance lessons and theater and lived vicariously. And in the background, I had this addiction happening in the closet. So I add a face to something that people, you know, can identify with. I keep saying that the addiction comes in every race, every demographic. And so the more that people can see that and see themselves in someone else and hopefully break that stigmatism, it brings light, you know, because I was wonderful. I had my wine in the closet.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Like a best friend.
Yeah, it was my friend, definitely. And it was, you know, and so was Adderall. So I had two different things that I was great, because people would say, well, how could you possibly drink like what you say you drank and still function like you did, because I own my own business. And I said, well, you know, I drank and I did Adderall.
And for how long did that work out?
It didn't work out. But it was a journey that I'm grateful at this point now. When I look back, I wouldn't be where I'm at today.
Well, every line, every fifth of vodka, every joint, every hit of ecstasy is made holy by staying sober. Anything that got me to this point was a godsend.
Right.
If I hadn't gone over the line, I wouldn't be where I'm at. And I'm very happy with where I'm at. I mean, the only people who live without drugs or alcohol are like monks, maybe nuns, except the ones who are thinking it.
Mormons do, except they take prescription drugs.
I was trying to throw a positive light on this.
Right, exactly.
And it's an incredibly courageous way to live. And most people just don't have the kahunas. I love speaking at AA meetings because I know I'm in a room of all people who probably almost died and decided at some point to live under any circumstances that they were in and make the best of it and improve their lives constantly. So it's courage. It takes courage not to get high. And a lot of people just don't have it. They're all, you know, when they say stick with the winners, anybody who's been sober for any amount of time, you know, to me, it is a big winner. It's a big winner because you're trading what you knew for the unknown. And most people don't have the courage to trade. They say kids who come from abused families are sometimes offered to be put into a new foster home or sent back to their family of origins. And most of them pick the family of origins because they know what to expect. They know how bad it is, but they got used to it. You know, you get used to it and you get to expect it. And the unknown is family that might be very sweet and loving, hopefully, is more frightening to them than what they already became accustomed to. So it's the same thing with recovery. You're going into uncharted waters. I told my sponsor in my first year, I said, you know, if you go out, I'm going with you because I don't like being here alone. And he was my guide. I said, it's like being dropped off into the middle of Siberia and having one, or Alaska, and having an Eskimo who can help you survive. And if he's gone, I didn't know how to live in a sober world. I didn't know anybody who was clean and sober. I didn't know anybody who didn't drink and use, some like I did, but some just normally. And so it was really like a whole new language, a whole new way of being that takes a while to get used to. And initially, you feel very awkward, you know, but there's something very magical. You know, and I'm opposed. I don't think rehab should take clients to meetings while they're in rehab. I think that's a place to get your head together and to decide whether or not you want to change your life. Because I know you're immediately stigmatized when you come into a meeting with a bunch of other people. And, you know, there's the aroma of vaping and whatnot. And,
aroma of vaping?
You know, the walking into an AA meeting, either alone or with a friend, and sitting down it's a little like going through the eye of the needle that Jesus talks about. On your own volition, to walk in alone to a meeting book or with a friend who says, hey, let me take you to a meeting, let me show you what is a meeting. It's a very magical moment. You feel surrounded by like-minded, open-hearted, you know, individuals. It's your own decision. You know, Bill Wilson never said, you know, bring those drunks to this meeting. So we, you know, he said, we're here for you. Come, the willingness. You know, it's attraction, not coercion. And I think that it taints the experience of going to AA when you're taken there by rehab, at least in the first few weeks.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think for myself, I checked in. I was one of the odd ones. When I first went, I ended up being in treatment for 114 days. I did inpatient, which is very unusual. Pardon me?
Give or take a day. No, I'm kidding. 114. You were counting.
Absolutely, because I know that they initially told me 30 days, and I said, you're out of your ever flippant mind. I'm not staying for 30 days. I have a business to get back to.
Right.
I don't relate to any of these people. And, you know, they did that very thing where we drove to the, you know, in the druggy buggy to the meetings. And I remember thinking.
Even that is such a, they talk about reducing the stigma of addiction. How about reducing the stigma of recovery?
Right.
Going in a druggy buggy is not a very attractive expression or description of a healing van, you know, right. In best term. It's a van for healing, but now it's a druggy buggy.
Right, and that's what everyone called it.
Yes, and I have a friend of mine, very sophisticated gentleman, who was taken by a very upscale rehab in a druggy buggy, and they vote on what station to listen to. So it was a rap station. It drove this guy out of rehab because he just didn't like it. It's, you know, it's aggressive, it's sexist, it's what? I mean, there's great rap, totally into it, but what they play on the radio, you don't have a choice of. And it literally drove him out of rehab because the driver couldn't handle silence. Or the people couldn't just say, let's have a conversation, let's look out the window. Right. No, we need bad rap music. And my friend had to leave because that's not part of the treatment plan. I don't see where any psychologist is saying, you know, 40 minutes of rap music once a day.
The one thing, though, I did notice, the common thread was, I'm really thankful I did stay 114 days, because I'll tell you, the common thread I found with about every 2 weeks, 10 days, people would come in and people would leave.
What would come in?
They would come in, they would check
people.
In.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Come in, and then they would leave within 5 to 10 days. I wanted to leave within 5 to 10 days because you could figure out every reason why you didn't belong there. So it could be the menu that they served wasn't, you know, some of it wasn't organic.
Mm-hmm.
The music they played. The one thing I did learn after being there 114 days is the people that did go through and saw the things that they needed were the ones that started to recover. Uh-huh. So there was a lot of things that I could look back on that period of time and say I didn't agree with. But now I look back in humility and say I'm really thankful of the things I did get from that experience. So I was very, very blessed to have met some people that really did teach me a great deal, because there's certainly things I didn't resonate with in treatment. And usually you don't, because you're super raw and you hate everybody. You just do.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone, you don't really like it. But as time goes on, I think what's I'm really.
My sponsor just walked in.
I have one too. Mine's Ari.
Ari.
Yeah, Ari. She's sleeping.
Named after my last 8 girlfriends. Her name is Lolita. Hello, Lolita.
Yeah. Well, I think your newsletter, and tell us what's going on with Real to Recovery. Is that something that...
It's a film festival all about addiction recovery, mental disorders, that takes place for the last 8 years in Los Angeles. It'll be our 9th year in October. It will be our 6th year. It's the longest recovery event anywhere in the country. It's 7 days. We do a 7-day film festival and symposium in New York in September. This will be our 6th year. October is Los Angeles for 7 days. We do a 3-day film festival in Denver in September. We do a 3 or 4-day film festival in Fort Lauderdale in November. We have film festivals coming up again in Houston. We were in San Francisco for a number of years. We just took a year off. Hopefully we'll get back to San Francisco. So it's almost like a franchise or a traveling film festival where we have a lot of clinicians and filmmakers and audience members. There's always an interactive group after every film, so we don't just show a film and say goodnight. We always have either a filmmaker or a clinician do a mini process group with the audience, and people talk about who they could relate to, and you know, who they're not as bad as that person, but oh my God, that reminds me of when I was this. And it's a really good, great conversations after the films. And we know a lot of people in recovery are not shy about sharing. So people speak up, it's great. This year we had showed a film called Chasing the Dragon that was produced by the FBI, and a couple FBI agents from Washington came to the theater in New York to present the film. And I asked one of them, what was his job at the FBI? He says, I'm in opiate crimes. And I said to him, I said, the only crime is that it's illegal. That's the only opiate crime. You know, why is heroin illegal and vodka is not? He couldn't answer me.
Mm. How do you select the films? Are you part of,
missions from all over the world. Scotland, Ireland, Australia, Iran. We had a great animated film from Iran about a ex-alcoholic boxer that was really inventive. So we're on a number of websites where people know if they have a film about these subjects, they can call us or send it to us. And I always have my eyes open for new films about the issue.
And then how does your newsletter, so if somebody wants to subscribe, get onto your newsletter, how do they go about doing that?
Tell them. They go to addictionrecoveryebulletin.org. Addictionrecoveryebulletin.org. You can subscribe there. It's absolutely free. The newsletter goes to 24,000 people every Tuesday morning, and a few minutes later it becomes the homepage of a website. So even if you don't subscribe, you can still get, and it's usually about 26 of the most recent current stories involving these issues, including some features. It's not a blog. There's no one just giving their opinion unless the opinion was in the New York Times. Then we'll print it. All very learned, educated people offering their opinion, but it's mostly news stories. New stories about addiction, some celebrity recovery, some addiction treatment scandals, policy, governmental policies affecting, the issues. So it's very interesting. It's been publishing it for 4.5 years now. AddictionRecoveryEbulletin.org. I think you like it.
You're kind of on the pulse of everything that's going on within the industry of recovery.
Yeah, at least what gets into the newspapers, and there's a lot of investigations going on, and there's a lot of great treatment centers. I mean, my life was saved at a treatment center when my son was 19 years old. He came to home one day, and he said, I want to go into treatment, and I said, okay. And then he says, but just for a week or two, like your friends, I said, well, you'll go for a month, you'll go for a month. And we called Betty Ford, and because I was an alumni, he got a scholarship. And I thought, oh, I'm so proud. My son got a scholarship to my university. And I remember driving him there, and halfway there, he says, Dad, I don't think this is such a good idea. Let's go. I said, no, they're expecting you. You don't want to disappoint them. You'll go, and if you don't like it after a week, I'll come pick you up. Luckily, he never called to have me come pick me up. Maybe enjoyed not having to talk to me for a month. His mother went and did family week, and he's been sober for 15 years, and he was 19 when he went.
Boy, that's amazing. That's a great.
Yeah. The right environment can change your brain chemistry. It's a month of not using.
Right.
Where your circuitry and your heart and your mind can realize, I can go back to the way it was, or I can change. It's a really simple choice. And some people go back. It's like recidivism in prison. people get comfortable with prison life, sadly. There's no surprises. And I guess addiction is like that too. You know what you're going to get. You're going to get high and you're going to get in trouble. And when you stop using, you have to go to work. You have to do things legally. You have to wash the dishes, which you don't have to do in a lot of rehabs. I appreciated that. I thought, this is the easiest life in my life. I don't have to cook and I don't have to wash dishes. I love this place. And all they want to talk about is me. Really, I got to write about myself. I got to tell stories about myself. Everyone's, the group therapy, the individual therapy. It's great for people who are self-centered if they're not afraid to uncover the crap. And I understand when people with severe trauma don't want to go there. But they should go there in a good rehab because that's where you can feel safe and address this. Because like they say, if you feel, you heal. You can't heal what you don't feel. So there will be this is a Gabor Mate. It's the underlying trauma that gets people to relapse. It's not their habits. It's not they're not going to meetings. It's these demons that come up that are so horrific and painful. You can only wash them away unless you are in a good, healthy environment where you can, deal with it and let it go.
You and I were totally opposite because for me, I hated that I couldn't cook. I wanted to clean. And I sure as hell didn't want the
folks. Obviously, you're putting together this whole program here. You're very ambitious.
I didn't want it to be all about me. Let me focus on your problems.
Now?
I was the opposite. When I went to rehab, they had to actually stop me and say, you're not here to clean or cook.
Uh-huh.
You need to just focus on you. And I was like, no, let me focus on someone else's in the room's problem. Like Leonard, he would have been a perfect person.
I've taken care of myself on and off for so many years. I loved it. It was like being at a consciousness raising resort.
Right.
And I was in with some good people at the time, like 20 men all having nervous breakdowns at the same time. Really hysterical. When I went there, I was a drug dealing pacifist, and my two best friends at rehab was an FBI agent and an arms manufacturer. But we got along and we made each other laugh. And that was more important than anything.
Right. So I think that's the wonderful thing is when you finally bridge over that, you start recognizing similarities that you have with everybody. And it's a very healing, but if someone, I always say, is watching this now and they question, I think I might have a problem, you do. Because the bottom line is, if you already start saying you're questioning that, you do. Yeah. It's just what you do to go about getting the help that you need. And I always say, let that inspiration, because you'll be led to where you need to go. And listen to your intuition, because oftentimes, reach out to people that you know and get recommendations as to what they did. There's also people that when they've had longer term sobriety, I say it's all about staying in recovery.
Well, I love the cliche that has helped me over the years. It's easier to stay sober than it is to get sober. I don't ever want to get sober again. That was a very... It was an incredibly awkward and uncomfortable month. It was easy, but it just felt bad all the time. It was easy as far as the not doing dishes. But to live without any substances for a month after having gotten high every day for 26 years, that's a whole new sense of discomfort that would have been impossible if it had not been for the program I went to. It wouldn't have been possible for me to quit everything on my own. I didn't even mention marijuana before I checked in. Or when I got there, I said, is this where I check in? And the woman looked at me. She says, it's not a hotel. This is where you get admitted. Okay. Can someone get my bags? No. Get them yourself. And it was, luckily I had snuck in a book. Because you're not allowed any outside reading material. You're certainly not allowed to watch TV. There's rehabs now where there's TVs in the room. Well, that'll really get you to reflect upon yourself.
Right.
You know, there were no television.
Yeah, like, no television, no radio.
No. I snuck in all that. Not the television. But I had a book that I read over and over. It was wonderful. Thank God. Although the big book stories in the back, when you've never read them, at night they will put you to sleep. They will help you sleep. Trust me. They're like, whoa.
I think one of my real moments to break through is I was sitting at this beautiful, beautiful place that I went to, and they put you out on the porch, and this is your time for reflection, and you need to work on yourself. And they have these herds of deer that would come through the yard, and they say, isn't this just beautiful? And I said, I don't like these deer. Who the hell? This is not nice.
Where were you? What?
I said, I remember saying, I hate the deer. This is everything about it. And then my moment of truth was going to a meeting that night and sitting next to someone who was detoxing and didn't have the luxury of going to a rehab facility.
Mm-hmm.
And they had someone to the right and to the left of them holding their hands because they were shaking so badly. And I remember at that moment thinking, what a horribly and grateful person I was that I had the luxury to go someplace. So I always tell someone, if you have the ability and the luxury to go to someplace, be thankful. Don't be angry, because that was that moment where I finally said how thankful I was, because I could have been that person that had not the ability to be able to go sitting in a luxury place and watching a deer prance. Yeah. You know, I'm cursing out the deer. I didn't say it in a very nice way. Just, you know, the deer.
I curse out the birds in the morning.
Yeah, I was like a stupid deer, and I want to see the damn. Like, who cares that there's mountains out there? You're out in the middle of nowhere. I thought it was just horrible, horrible thing. So, anyways, in retrospect, be very thankful. And if that's the message that we could send out to everyone, that if you have an ability to go into a setting, that's wonderful. And then also, like I say over and over again, that it is a continual effort on everyone's part to stay in recovery. And also, it's our responsibility, those that are in recovery, to put their hand out and say it can be done. And we are an example that it can be done, and that to continually put it out there. Now, you've started, you know, two wonderful organizations and things that continue to reach out to people all the time and continue to grow in its size, because I don't think that, I mean, the epidemic of addiction just continues to grow, unfortunately.
And yeah, why do you think that is?
I think it's a couple different things. I think in our society, we have the luxury of a lot of spare time. And I do believe that we have a lot of overstimulants.
Mm-hmm.
We're constantly, you know, you talk about that you didn't really think, oh, well, sex addictions. I'm here to tell you, I was in a relationship with someone that had that issue, very much so. So I think that it touches people's lives. And I think that we're given the luxury, because we have such abundance, to respond in the way. Many countries, they don't get the opportunity to say, I'm going to go drink now, when they have trauma.
Mm-hmm.
We have trauma, and we have such abundance that's going on in our lives. Oftentimes, we get that opportunity that many people don't. So I think there's a lot of different factors that are going on, that are happening within our society. I think that, you know, the overstimulus, I had Lee Gerds on from Brain State Technology.
There could be a real lack of joy and happiness.
Right.
Nurturing and love.
Maybe, yeah, getting back to the basics.
Maybe parents are too busy working to keep up with the Joneses to love their children.
Right.
More. And the love of God through an injection of heroin can't be beat. It's like Lenny Bruce said, whenever he did a shot of heroin, he felt like he was being kissed by God. Where are you going to get, you know, where are you going to get that kind of feeling? From your school? From your job after work? From your parents who aren't home? From your phone? People want love. And if you can do something that makes you feel loved, I want more of that. And maybe part of getting sober is to be able to live without feeling loved for a while, except by the people, except by your new friends and your family who love you again. I don't know. I'm not saying everybody comes from shitty, dysfunctional families.
Right.
But if you look at America right now, I would assume half the people do come from shitty, dysfunctional families in the state of America as it is today in February 2017. Okay. It's a strange place.
Yeah. I had Melissa Moody. She's on part of this summit, and she was in the documentary Happy. And
there's another one out on Netflix called The Minimalists.
I love them too.
Very good.
Yes.
Really well done documentary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So Melissa, that was her, that whole documentary, Happy, that's the foundation.
Yeah.
That our country as a whole, some of the countries that are the happiest have the least amount when it comes to monetary things, but they have a sense of community and love.
You know, Indians selling knives on the street in Bombay have a better sense of well-being than people working in the suburbs, or people who live in the suburbs and work in the city. So.
Well, that's why I think the foundation of the community of AA and what Bill W. started, really, it's really about
the best. The best. It's extraordinary. You have hundreds of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of loners who've come together. Create this incredible organization. I remember the first time I went to a meeting in New York City. I walked in, I called central office. I was really freaking out from being in New York sober for the first time. They told me where a meeting was. I went in, I walked in, and it blew my mind that no one asked me for ID or who sent you. It's like this amazing secret private organization that all you have to do to feel like you belong is to go. I mean, right. Not drinking and using helps, but to walk into a room and feel at home 3,000 miles away and no one's asking me, like I said, who sent me, like a nightclub or a speakeasy. And then to sit there and hear someone share about how grateful they were that they had just been given a winter coat. It was November in New York. And the guy was just oozing with gratitude that he'd just been given a winter coat. You know, the simple things in life can make us so grateful. And maybe a lot of American societies are not taught to appreciate the intrinsic value of life itself, of things that don't cost money, like literature and books and good newspapers, good magazines, friendships, walking, nature, museums, going to, you know, every museum has a free day, so you can't say you can't afford to go to a museum. Every museum has one day that's on the house. And, you know, maybe that's where rehab should take people, to museums instead of meetings.
In addition,
like, hey, appreciate something by just observing it and see the beauty and the genius of the work of the artist. Could make you feel like you have that in you? You know, how does God appear in this earth? Is, they say, through people.
Right. You know,
through mothers loving their children, through artists, through architects, you know, designing amazing buildings, through builders building amazing buildings, and certainly through filmmakers and people like yourself who decide they want to, like, do something interesting and help spread the message and let people know that, you know, recovery is achievable. It's preferable to addiction, I have to think. It's maybe, I don't know. I can't speak for an addict who's happily using. You know, how many doctors are on heroin because they, you know, they know how to get away with it. They love it. God bless them. You know, but everybody else who is unmanageable, when your life has become unmanageable. My life never became unmanageable. I managed my life like a drug addict. Okay. It became unpleasant, but it didn't become unmanageable because I managed it like a drug addict manages his habit. And there's a lot of people who are very high-functioning alcoholics, and one day maybe they'll have the insight or the courage or the inspiration to want to try to live life naturally. I mean, if it's true what Ringo Starr said, all you have to do is act naturally and be natural, like Mr. Natural. Like the people in the programs and NA and all of them, you know, the steps, it's a phenomenal way to live. You know, it's not easy, it's not always comfortable, but it's the better mousetrap, is what I like to say. You know, it's the better mousetrap.
I think every day I feel incredibly blessed meeting people like yourself, meeting the people that I continually meet that have chosen to kind of get to the other side. And then
I do feel we're at the other side of this conversation.
Well, Leonard, I love you.
Thank you, Debbie.
I think you're so phenomenal, and I love you, and I love your work. It's wonderful that, you know, it's a newsletter. People can be log on, get a part of continual education from you. The work that you do is amazing. So thank you for taking the time
doing this very much.
Thank you, Leonard.
See you soon.
Bye.
Bye. Sing it. We will rock you.
A big disgrace, waving your banner all over the place.
We will rock you.
Sing it!
We will rock you.
Buddy, you're an old man, poor man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you zombie someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace. Somebody better put your bag into your place.
We will rock you.